For those that came to DevConf, this is basically the same talk. The intention of this talk was to get an ARM device collecting a whole bunch of sensor data, writing it into the cloud and demoing it that way. In the time between I envisaged doing that and now, well, Fedora just keeps eating up my time. And I've got a bunch of stuff done, but not enough to demo. Because what I wanted to be able to do was like demo the sense data of IoT, shoving it into Elasticsearch, graphing it over time and things like that, but then also basically demo an upgrade using Atomic on IoT, a failed upgrade, a rollback of said upgrade, and various other things that I'll cover off in this talk. So unfortunately that's partially working, but not really good enough with an appropriate set of slides to go with it. So I failed back to the existing talk, and hopefully once F23 is out and we have a whole bunch of interesting new Docker features on different architectures for F23, I might get some breathing space to finish off that little project. But anyway, in the interim, we have what we have. Is it just ARM? No. Is it just embedded devices? No. IoT covers a lot of space, a lot of devices, a lot of things. We have the endpoints, which these days are generally small, tiny embedded ARM devices. We have gateways. In the case of home gateways, they are more small embedded ARM devices. In the case of industrial IoT or large-scale IoT, they are generally big x86 servers with wireless controllers and various other bits and pieces on them. You have message gateways. M2M is machine to machine. Jared, oh, don't come in. Yay, it just works on Fedora. you'll have messaging systems. These are both M2M, which is machine to machine. So you might have a sensor device that's collecting a whole bunch of environmental stuff, and then you might say heat data in a data center, and that might be then connected to another IoT device that is controlling the air conditioning or the HVAC systems to adjust the temperature of the room in response. And then you'll have machine to data, which is more your logging thing, so you can see the temperature of the data center over a period of time. So you've got data gathering, data storage and data analytics. Obviously, data security with various different breaches and various different public things that are ongoing right through the IT industry and the Linux industry with things like Heartbleed and various other bits and pieces are obviously very important in IoT and are certainly being discussed in the IoT industry these days, but I don't believe that yet at a cohesive, straightforward solution that's applicable everywhere. So there's a lot of beginning to become a lot of awareness and a lot of discussion about it, but there doesn't appear to be like a single cohesive IoT security strategy. So this is a fairly standard IoT device stack with libraries and APIs, protocols, and obviously down to things like wireless communication and bits and pieces. This image is courtesy of the ARM guys because I haven't managed to find a better one. So, covering endpoint devices, they need to be low cost, almost disposable devices. ARM devices are obviously driving this revolution because they're low cost, low power, and persuasive everywhere. So there's already lots of tools, toolkits, and various other bits and pieces to deal with them. You get Arduino ones, which are very low end, small amounts of code, small amounts of RAM, you know, that can wear on your wrist or, you know, almost disposable, or more capable devices like the BeagleBone and the Raspberry Pi and other similar style devices. There's a number of OSs out there, Contiki OS and Tiny OS, both around the Cortex M series, which are this uber low power stuff that you're finding in things like electronic door locks and things like that. And then as you come further up the stack, there's Pokey, Open Embedded, and Yocto, which is a compile from base, but fairly generic, supported across hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of devices and a number of different architectures, which is more closer to the sort of space that Fedora would compete in on your BeagleBone style devices.
Is that just embed as well?
Sorry?
On the small end, is embed as well?
Yes. I should actually add that. It was sort of just starting to.
Yeah. It's open source apparently, so
I actually have a device at home, which is an IBM tie-up thing for embed with the IBM cloud IoT in my stack of to play with devices. Never enough hours in the day. So Fedora on IoT endpoints, you know, x86 obviously. Some people were lucky enough to get a Raspberry Pi style x86 device in their bag. ARMv7 and obviously ARP64 incoming at some point with the potential. I think atomic images for IoT is the perfect fit. You can create a direct image, you can do a remote update on it. When you update, you go, right, update seems okay, set a watchdog, reboot. On reboot, you have a process that checks local things like local sensors, but also it's all very well having a device boot okay, but if, say, the network device doesn't come up or the wireless interface is screwed, you still end up with a brick. That's useful. So you boot it up, you run basically a test script to test all of these minimum features that you need, and then you unset the watchdog and you go, right, we're good. If that hasn't completed by the time the watchdog triggers, like say a minute or 2 minutes later, the watchdog issues a hardware reset and you automatically deal with, in the boot process, the rollback to the previous good. And there was, a few months ago, there was an IoT home manufacturer that was producing these $100, $200, thereabouts, IoT gateways that had, I think, either Bluetooth 4 or Zigbee or something like that. And they sent out to in excess of 100,000 gateway devices a firmware update that bricked them all. And they then had to send emails out to all their registered users saying, we've just broken your device. Please put it in a post, like a reply post to this address, and we will send you out a fixed one shortly. That's expensive. I'm not even sure whether that, I mean, that's a situation that if it happens to a company, it can send them broke. And so something like Atomic would mitigate the vast majority of those screw-ups. We've got in Fedora support for the 802.15.4 stack, Bluetooth LE, and various other technologies. We've got enabled. There's still some upstream support to to do a bunch of the features, but 6-low WPAN, which is a stripped down IPv6 to go over small networks. There's some routing protocols and various other bits and pieces, and as you go higher up the stack, there's MQTT, which is a cut-down message queue technology, which we have support for through a bunch of different protocol stacks within Fedora, including Mosquito and RabbitMQ. We would have ActiveMQ support when the supposed maintainer actually gets around to updating it to a new version. And obviously we have the ability to deal with firmware fixes and various other bits and pieces. No management framework yet for things like firmware updates and things like that.
But the newer stuff that's happening around EFI, firmware standardization and so on, using capsules, right?
Yeah, but I mean, that would be not so much for upgrading the OS.
Right. No, but I mean for expanded programming and firmware.
Yeah, I mean, there's a whole bunch of technologies there, and I've not looked at it closely because it's a purchase that Red Hat made designed for the mobile area, but there's Feed Henry that does a certain bunch of mobile, and when it's open sourced, I'm sure that we can possibly adjust it a bit, and it could be a whole bunch of that sort of stuff has the potential to be repurposable for things like IoT, because they're not that dissimilar to mobile device management. So 802.15.4 is a open base level wireless implementation. It's used for Zigbee and a bunch of other protocols. Google has adopted it as part of the thread group stack, which runs IPv6 and various other bits and pieces. The group there is very industry oriented and not so much oriented to open source contribution, in that you've got even as a private member, you've got $1,000 a year as a member fee or something like that. But they're starting to publish some more standards, and it will be interesting to see if they do an open source like standard implementation of the lower levels of the thread stack. And I've covered basically the 6-low WPAN, which was the IPv6, which is what Thread is using for their low layer routing. Gateways, I'll just cover this quickly, but basically a bridge from these lower level wireless protocols that speak to devices in your house or devices in the factory, to bridge it over to the standard network and the standard internet. In a lot of cases, they're routers, but they can also be things like an MQTT caching layer or an M2T themselves, so that you can have all completely local traffic, and even to some degree a data collector and forwarder, because you'll have something like a doorknob. You don't want to power up a hell of a lot because you want it to run on a AA battery for a year. And so it'll power up, it'll query MQTT, and it'll say, here, I've got these cache messages for you. Here's something to deal with. Or it'll power up because it's just unlocked the door for someone, and it will send those logs back to a logging device to say, Joe, or RFID X has entered the building at this time. So gateways can function as a number of things, and as I mentioned earlier, they can be a small device in the home or a much larger, higher-end server to deal with hundreds of thousands of devices in a factory. So here's a basic IoT. You've got a bunch of nodes meshed together, a gateway, and onto the internet. Messaging systems. MQTT is message queue for telemetry, a protocol that was originally proprietary, came out of IBM, and has got quite a bit of traction. It's really nice and simple and seems to work fairly well. There's a number of projects, including ActiveMQ and Mosquito, as I mentioned earlier, and a number of client implementations in Python, Java, and various other bits and pieces, as well as a number of sort of startup hosted platforms. RoboMQ is one. I think there's one called OpenSensor IoT or something like that, which is announced recently, which is actually based out of London. And so there's a bunch of interesting projects and everything from open source do-it-yourself to hosted platforms. Constrained application protocol is your messaging queue system is very much for machine to machine, and machine a number of different things. CoAP is much more similar to HTTP, so you'll have a client or a gateway or various other bits and pieces actually actively polling a CoAP server. So it relies on a sort of stripped down version of REST, low overhead, and it doesn't compete with, but it's useful alongside MQTT for different use cases, basically. The lightweight machine-to-machine is just a standard messaging protocol that can be embedded in CoAP or MQTT, primarily on CoAP, for it's basically an object model to enable standardized inter-device communications. And it has, you know, your standard dictionaries and the ability to define various bits and pieces, and enhance dictionaries, or you can push out bits to devices so they know how to communicate with each other. And then smart objects, another open thing, uses the previous, or can use the previous lightweight machine to machine, and it's for things like naming of sensors, user input and output. So you would use these sort of things to say, I have a smart light, turn it on, turn it off, set the hue, set the color, that sort of things for different device profiles, from, you know, thermostats to lights to industrial machines or whatever they happen to be. So using Fedora for data analytics and storage, IoT is probably, in my opinion, one of the better uses or better verticals of big data. You can feed vast amounts of data in and analyze it and get vast amounts of data out. And so from this perspective, a lot of the IoT side of things is no different than any other big data problem. And there's a bunch of tools we have in Fedora, and a bunch of tools out there in the industry that answer this solution very well, from Elasticsearch, Hadoop, Google Cloud Platform launched a streaming API data analysis, which enables you to do both streaming analysis and static analysis of data. So there's a bunch of interesting projects out there where this is suited very, very well for IoT stuff. There's obviously with Apache Spark, Apache Hadoop, Elasticsearch, which sits on top of Lucene, a number of awesome open source projects for this as well, most of which run pretty well on Fedora. And obviously, you know, you then integrate into phones and bits and pieces like that for mobile alerting. Hey, you're away on holidays and your front door's just opened. you know, why. Not so much stuff in Fedora for that at the moment, although there was a discussion earlier in Flock about would it be possible for Fedora to provide a means of doing open source Android apps and getting them published into, you know, the Android App Store or the Apple App Store and things like that for people that are interested in doing open source apps but don't have the ability to deal with that. So that was an interesting sort of talk, not really related to IoT, but has the potential to be with regards to open source. And obviously storage as well, various different databases and Elasticsearch and, you know, again, similar to big data. There's nothing particularly, in my opinion, IoT specific when it comes to these solutions. I personally don't see a lot of value in investing a lot of time in doing an IoT specific thing where you can use a general thing and existing technologies that are known to work. But again, a thing that we do relatively well in Fedora for a lot of that already. I mean, looking at the data grepper data store with Fed message is a perfect way of seeing how we're using technologies in Fedora to deal with what is essentially a big data problem for data analytics and stuff like that. And there's no reason that couldn't be used for, or the same style of system used for, say, an IoT style platform. Security. As I mentioned earlier, certainly a massive, big issue or looming potential issue in IoT. I don't think it'll be long before we see some fairly large breaches about this. If it was someone's home thermostat, it might not be so much of a problem.
Well, the example that I'm getting recently was even with that rate. So let's say that you compromise all the light bulbs in a city.
Yeah.
Then if you adjust them all at once.
Yes, you can overload the power grid.
Power grid instabilities.
Or
if somebody's on fire, if you play with enough thermostats.
Yeah, well, I mean, everyone always talks about, you know, the internet-connected toaster.
Right.
In the UK, it's a known problem that at the end of a football match or in the middle of, at a break of a football match, everyone goes and puts on a kettle.
Yeah.
And it massively overloads the grid. And
he's not joking, there's a hydro storage.
Yeah, there is a hydro storage thing which they can start generating power in about 3 seconds flat. And it has basically up in a mountain a massive store of water and a whole bunch of pipes, and it goes down into a lake below, and once they've finished with it overnight, once they use some of the generated power to pump the water back up the top.
Yes. Standards.
Yeah, in the past it was EastEnders, but now it tends to be, you know, any major thing. And it, you know, in the ARM case, if you go and remotely turn on everyone's kettle,
yep.
You know,
we have one of those hydro dams and hydro storage batteries in mass, by the way. I don't know why we have one.
So, as I don't remember who said it, but the internet of other people's things. And you know, IT security is not a new thing. Security on Linux is certainly not a new thing. Dealing with security issues on Linux is not a new thing. There's been a lot of recent, the Viper issue on KVM, or on Qemu cloud platforms, both Xen and KVM, Heartbleed. There's a number of recent ones that a good indication of the way the security industry is changing, and some of the, you know, Linux Foundation initiatives and that to help mitigate that is a classic example of the Linux community reacting to security issues and trying to, and so there's no reason All these principles can't apply to IoT. SE Linux everywhere. Atomic images to enable easy upgrades with rollback for the inevitable, as the example I gave earlier, not well QA'd product update. You know, the
spam radio exploits, you know, embedded firmware issues.
Yes.
So many of them as well.
You know, the recent Intel, we have this ancient old feature that is easily in the chip layer problem. I mean, you know, they are many and vast. Network security, I mean, all these devices are connected, and if you don't secure, you know, security is only as good as your weakest link. So 802.15.4 has inbuilt security, automatic rekeying, various other bits and pieces. All these tiny little embedded chips generally have even a basic crypto offload engine to enable things like that. SSL or TLS by default on all applications. You know, these are things that the industry in Linux has learned a lot about in the last 12 to 18 months. And I would hope the IoT industry, as they use Linux, you know, learns from the industry at large. I fear that may be one of the major downfalls, as they use just old stuff that's already running. Application security, you know, you can secure everything at a lower level, but if the upper layers aren't secured, you know, as I mentioned, atomic images for easy updates and rollbacks, regular, constant, consistent updates. All things that, you know, we're dealing with in Fedora. But, you know, how many IoT devices? Gartner says 26 billion, Cisco says 50 billion, Intel says 200 billion. You know, there's, I don't think anyone knows. And the fact of the matter is, when we get to 2020, there's going to be all these organizations or their equivalent ones reporting all sorts of different figures. Because I suspect we'll be in a situation that, you know, nobody knows. So, is security a problem? Yes, every which way you look at it, there's going to be a problem. So there's important, there's diversity in IoT platforms, competition, you know, various other bits and pieces to ensure, you know, companies that are delivering a, you know, a base IoT firmware image, that there is choice out there in competition. And I personally think security should be one of those major competitions. I mean, it's all very well being able to get data, and if the device is cheap and all that, that's all very well and good. But if you've got 10 million devices out there that are suddenly compromised, you're going to have a lot of egg. The companies are going to have a lot of egg on their face. So, I mean, I think Fedora is a great building block to build all of this. We have a lot of the technologies starting to come together to enable an awesome IoT platform with things like Atomic and, you know, security updates and some of the new rings policy packaging and things like that. Of course, there's still a lot to do, you know, but the base is there. You know, there's enhancements going on in the industry like thread group and that, and if we can sort of implement that and be able to test that, and bits, all the building blocks for that are already in Fedora and runnable. But you know, there's obviously ongoing enhancements, everything from new packages, updating packages, tweaking bits and pieces, and end-to-end testing. Thank you. Any questions?
Discovery is the other piece that's missing a lot of these conversations. So how devices discover each other. And there's a whole bunch of consortia right now working on, you know, one of my friends is working on called HyperCap in the UK, which is probably, you know, examples of this. But there's a whole bunch of them. Like, how do smart devices discover each other?
Well, the thread stack also implements
exactly.
bits and pieces like that, and there's talks of, like, you know, embedding RFID in the devices. So you basically go and put the RFID, the device on top of the gateway, and they pair using RFID and set a security key. And there's going to be a lot of competition there. There's thread group, there's three or four related, but similar, but slightly different consortia.
So I think there's two outcomes of Fedora that would be useful in Fedora. One would be an actual IoT effort in Fedora.
Yep.
Using the technology we already have. So agree, there's no point being made for real. And the second thing is a comprehensive, not boiling the ocean reference example.
Yep.
Where you say, here's a little device generating some data, it's aggregated, processed using whatever technology you want to do, spark something on an x86 and power and whatever in the cloud, end-to-end example.
Yeah, completely agree. And as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, I was hoping to have the basics of that in place.
Correct.
But, you know.
We can talk because we're looking at doing that for
yeah.
some time.
I mean, I would love help. I mean, I have a whole bunch of ideas in my head how to do that, and just not enough time and cycles to do that. And, you know, if people want a little project or a big project or a series of projects to come and help out and start to play.
Let's formalize some kind of IoT skunkworks. That's it.
I mean, we should. I thought the other day that we should actually just get a mailing list as a start to start this discussion.
We don't have that done by.
Exactly, Denise. Where's my hub already?
Can you just put us on the seat?
So, yeah, I mean, there's things like that. I mean, we've got dozens and dozens of building blocks there that are being used in the industry that we've already got in Fedora.
We have this overwhelming opportunity that we are not addressing right now, so we should be addressing.
Yeah. And, I've had all these ideas in my head, but I am one person, and one person doesn't create an IoT stack. I forget who I said it to earlier. It's like I wanted to do this demo, and if I had 2 weeks to sit down and just work on this, it would be working and it would be beautiful. I mean, it won't take that much time, but I know a number of you in here are very aware that actually taking 2 weeks out to hack on a prototype and get it up and running, I wish I had 2 weeks spare to do that. I'm sure there's people in the business that would say, yeah, we will give you the 2 weeks to go and do that, but there's going to be 50 other people in the business going, where's all these bits and pieces that you're also doing?